Hopefully, I don't know if everyone will jump over to the new one. Maybe you could post a thing to Cliff and Nisha to have everyone jump over to the new live stream. Okay. Sorry, guys. I'm not sure if this one is... Okay, here we are. All right, you guys, I'm really sorry about that. Yeah, it is coming back. It is back. A few people are joining in here. Cliff and Nisha, Jerry's going to text you and have people jump over to this live stream. So really sorry about that. Like I said, you never know what's going to happen with live video. That's one of the exciting, fun things about doing live streams. Okay, so back to the melon question here. The question is, can we, no, let me flip over to my previous page here. The question is about melons, okay? Can we, will we need to harvest melons on a trellis? So the video we did last week was on growing sugar baby melons in a Smart Pots Little Shorty, an awesome growing container for a small space. Did a super quick, simple, inexpensive trellis. So if you missed that video, definitely something that you want to go back and check out. But I will be covering how to trellis in a separate video, but we do have videos on that from last year. And yes, you will need to harness them. Super, super easy to do though. A couple different things you can harness or net up or support the sugar babies with. The first one is one of my favorites, works especially well for sugar babies, and that is knee-high pantyhose. So super easy, quick, simple, inexpensive. You can just make a little sling with your knee-high pantyhose, hanging on to the trellis. And I see a lot of people are finding us over here on the new stream. So thank you so much for your patience. And we're talking about supporting watermelon on a trellis. So the small baby watermelons, the sugar babies, super easy to support with a knee-high pantyhose, or cut up an old t-shirt and use it for that. One thing for the large size watermelon that worked really well for me last year, and you might have seen my videos on that, we're going to be growing watermelon on this trellis again this year. Last year we grew a couple of 20 pounders. Definitely need some support. You don't want to go to all that work and then your watermelon fall off the vine. So what I like to do is use these little pieces of netting. This is a bird netting you can pick up on Amazon. They also do have little watermelon supports that are real heavy duty netting, but this works pretty well. You get a big old length of it. I'm not sure, I don't remember how much it costs, but it's super inexpensive. And what you can do, it's very easy, is you just put your watermelon in the support, and we'll do videos on that as we're growing here, and then just tie it up to your trellis. So very, very simple. And you always want to keep some of this around too, because it can be handy for bird netting. Definitely handy to support vines on a trellis. And I would love to hear in the chat what you'd like to support your watermelon with. But watermelon is such a fun fruit to grow, and I really want to encourage you to grow it if you haven't yet. And now is a perfect time to even start from seed the sugar babies, because they're a lot quicker to go from seed to harvest in maybe 6 to 8 weeks, as opposed to about 4 months for a full-size watermelon. And I've got seeds for those in my melon seed collection and in the container garden seed collection, so you can grab those. And I don't know if a lot of you heard, but we will not be live streaming next week for Memorial Day. So just keep that in mind, and hope you have a great barbecue with your families. Okay, so we did have another question on watermelon, and this one was from Days in My Life. And this one is, can we save the seeds and use it for next year's melons? And yes, you can save seeds as long as your variety is an heirloom variety. I mean, you can save seeds from any varieties, but the heirloom varieties will grow true to the mother plant next year. They're well-established plants. Well, the line is, the seeds are very established, and they will grow true to type on next year's fruit. And that holds true for any heirloom. You can definitely save seeds from anything, but you're kind of running the gamut on varieties that aren't heirloom, if they'll cross-pollinate or if they'll grow a little bit differently next year. But definitely save those seeds. Your melons will have tons of seeds in there for you to save for next year. Okay, so let's jump into the chat and let me know if you're growing watermelon, what variety you're growing, and if you have any trellising tips, or if you have any other questions, we'll answer them now before we move on to the next question that I had, that I pulled from the YouTube videos. Okay, let's see here. Is it okay to grow sugar baby in the little shorty? Okay, Ramona, we did a whole video on that last week. Go back and watch that. It works great in the little shorty because it's a nice compact size. So perfect for growing in small spaces. You are gonna love it. And the video will be super, super helpful for you. You can grab little shorties over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. And I have those in stock on my website. Smart Pots has them as well as plenty of other sizes for you to grow in. And before I forget, you guys, today and tomorrow are the last days to order the Grow Your Groceries with Callie Kim May subscription box. So use the code Grow Your Groceries for $7 off. You don't want to miss out on the May box. It's a good one. One of my favorite things that's in the May box, and the theme, by the way, is Grow Your Power Producers. So all the seeds in there, there's 4 seed packets all together in there, are vegetables that will grow you a ton of veggies over the summer. Super special seeds. One of my favorites, you guys might think these look like squash or pumpkins. These are called Diva Cucumbers. The absolute prima donna of cucumbers, one of my favorites. You don't want to miss out on these, guys. These are an amazing cucumber. So all the seeds I really specially curate, kind of really special seeds for all the subscription boxes. So don't miss out on May. You can grab that over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. Okay, I just saw Patricia scroll by a comment that said Saturday is her birthday. So happy birthday, Patricia. You've been part of this community for a really long time, and I hope you have a really special day on your birthday and get to spend some time with your family or doing something that you really, really enjoy. Okay, Smart Pods, yeah, they are crazy, crazy beautiful. I've got some planted already and planning on getting a lot more put in this week. So yeah, Cliff, Diva Cucumber, who would thought? They're actually, they only grow female flowers. And they are self-pollinating, so they don't need bees to pollinate. So if you are short on bees in your garden, grab yourself the May box, and the Diva Cucumbers are in there along with some other special varieties, a round zucchini squash, a trilogy bean mix, and you are going to absolutely love growing with the May box. You'll be able to grow a lot of groceries. Okay, Jack, how you doing, Jack? With the first frost of mid to late October, when is the latest I can plant full-size watermelon seeds like Dixie Queen or Tender Sweet? Okay, Jack, what you want to do is find out how many days to maturity those particular varieties take, and then back up from that, at least that number of days, plus I want to say give or take maybe a month or so, because watermelon need a long period of warm temperatures. So figure out when the temperatures in your area start to cool down. It might be in September. So you'd want to back up that amount of time from when you start to get cooler weather to hopefully give yourself the best chance of being able to harvest some watermelon. And they definitely need lots of sunlight. And as you come into September and October, the hours of sunlight get less. So kind of do a little bit of math and figure that out so you have the best chance for harvesting. And I know you have a lot of space, so you do have the space to kind of play with if you don't have it filled up with other things, so that even if you don't get a harvest, at least you get a good run of it and you can kind of adjust for next year. Okay, let's see what other questions we have here in the chat. And let's see, B says, I got a little bit crazy having the phone and tablet to see the chat. It's always good to kind of go back and forth and have lots of things going on there. And Debbie will be direct sowing some Diva cucumbers today. She's a subscriber to our Grow Your Groceries box and having a great time with it there in Hawaii, and growing really well over there. So Debbie, let me know how those go. I think you're really, really gonna enjoy it. And Mira says, hello, Callie Kim. I'm enjoying my subscription box. Lots of people having fun with it. So really glad that you're enjoying it, Mira. And this box in particular has been very popular. A lot of people say the boxes just keep getting better every month. And the June box is no exception for that. We'll be sharing more about that over on our website over in the coming days. So make sure you stay tuned for that. Okay, 808 Ladybugs. This year, I am so overwhelmed with cucumbers, only 2 plants, lots of pickles and kimchi. That sounds absolutely delicious. It's a good problem to have, and you can always give some away too, right? Okay, let's move on to our next question. And this one is on pest control, okay? And the Gore 54 Miller says, I'm being invaded by earwigs in San Jose. Could you make a video on Bonide products, specifically spinosad and how to use it? Okay, I actually have a couple of videos on that. You want to go back and check out the Organic Pest Control Solutions video, where I show you how to use the bug and slug killer and also Captain Jack's Dead Bug Brew, which both contain spinosad. And spinosad is pretty cool because it's a targeted pest control ingredient in those products. So it kills the bad bugs, but not the good bugs. So there's all different types. There's spinosad comes in different forms. The bug and slug control, it's in a granule. The Captain Jack spray is in a spray, obviously. And it's a great kind of all around. Those two are really good all around pest control products to have in your garden shed. That way you're covered. I love the bug and slug killer because it's easy to sprinkle around your garden beds. And I've gotten to the point where I really don't plant anything without it because of the earwigs and the pill bugs. And the good thing is it lasts for up to a month. So do go back and check out those videos. And it's always good to have a couple things around, not only for prevention, because it's always much easier to prevent a big problem than to, you know, try and control it when it gets out of hand. So I always recommend have some things on hand for prevention, and then they're there for you. So you're armed and ready. If things do get out of hand, you have something there to spray on the bugs. And that way you're not rushing around trying to find something that works. And do always make sure that you check the video descriptions, because I've done a lot of the heavy lifting for you, used a lot of these products for years. That way you don't have to waste your money on products that don't work or that you haven't tried, and then follow the directions on the bottle, on the spray, on the container, and you should be good to go. But definitely check those links below so all the resources, you have all the resources that you need. Okay, here's another question about pest control, and then we'll answer your questions in the chat again. And all about that wife and mom life said, I bought the seeds from you and unfortunately they did too well and they all sprouted. I have them growing in a 4-inch container. And the question is about the Neem Max, which I sprayed some Neem Max in the video we did last week on the sugar baby watermelon. The Neem Max, does it work on already established plants and soil, or is it best to use at planting? And I say both. That's definitely something you want to spray every 10 to 14 days, again, to help prevent the problems before they pop up. The Neem Max is a really cool product because it's a 4-in-1 product, and it will kill all stages of the bug, from the egg to the larva to the mature adult pest. So I sprayed on the soil to kill the bugs and then sprayed on the plants to help prevent the powdery mildew. But then you can also spray it on established plants throughout the growing season to help control and prevent powdery mildew and diseases, which is a huge problem, especially on like the cucumbers, the squash, the watermelon. So it really does work well to help prevent and control issues again before they pop up, which is always way, way easier to do. A lot of people lose their plants every year to powdery mildew and downy mildew. So whatever you can do to prevent it from even happening, you're gonna have that much more to harvest. So super, super effective pest and disease control. Okay, let's see here. Let me scroll through the chat and see what kind of questions we have. Nisha, the passion fruit is going crazy, but looks great. Any fruits yet? It is just starting to flower, Nisha. Yeah, it's right there behind me on the archway there. You might be able to see a couple little flowers popping out, but there are all kinds of flower buds on it. So just waiting to open up. So I'm really anticipating a great harvest of passion fruit this year. I may need some ideas on what to do with all that passion fruit. We like to scoop it out and put it over yogurt. I've been kind of lightly blending it for a passion fruit type of syrup to add to beverages and that type of thing, or to pop in my smoothies. Juice it. Yeah, I'm going to try that, Nisha. So let me know if anyone else has any ideas. I have a feeling we're going to need some ideas for how to use passion fruit this year. Okay, let me scroll through here. Does the Nemax also kill beneficial insects? Okay, you definitely want to spray it early in the morning or in the evening before the bees are out. And I would spray, when you spray the leaves, try to avoid spraying the flowers, but it does especially help control the chewing and sucking insects on the leaves. Since the bees don't chew and suck on the leaves, it's very effective against those chewing and sucking insects. So you should be good to go as long as you spray it before the bee activity or when the bee activity is less. Okay, let me scroll through here and see what other questions we have. And yeah, it is helpful if you write question in front so I can spot them easily. The chat tends to scroll by very, very quickly. P. Treadway, Patricia says, I love the way the ladder mesh fits inside the little shorty smart pots. Yeah, it really does make a really perfect little garden arch for a little shorty. And it looks so pretty in the garden as well. You can always add a couple of extra little stakes in it. Let me just show you guys. It's right down here. You can see that in the little shorty there. It's right down there. And you can always add a couple little garden stakes to the side if you want to kind of shore it up just a little bit more. But you really can't go wrong with the ladder mesh. It's just a super quick, simple, inexpensive trellis. And a lot of people ask me where to find it. Ask in the masonry department. If you're not seeing it there, ask at like the contractor's desk at Home Depot. I did put a link for it in the video description of that video so that you can go and kind of see what it looks like. It's a Home Depot link. So you might be able to identify what aisle of the store it's located in or make sure that you have it at your local Home Depot, but that's the store where I found it. So if you have one of those in your area, hopefully you're in luck for that. Okay, Nisha in Africa, we used to make passion fruit juice and have it chilled on hot days. Oh my goodness, that sounds so good. So I'll definitely have to try that. It'd be super refreshing. It's kind of a tart type of fruit. So sometimes if we put it over yogurt, we might mix like some honey in it or something like that. Debbie, passion fruit mousse is delicious. I'm gonna have to get a recipe for that, Debbie. I think you've mentioned that before. So I'll definitely have to look that one up. Okay, Stacy, this is a great question. My chard and other lettuce here in Maryland are taking off. Anyone have a tip on how to store and to keep it fresh longer? Okay, it's always fun to see your garden vegetables taking off with the weather's warming up. Sometimes you can just see them grow day by day. Sometimes they just sit there for a while because the weather is cold. So always a lot of fun when they take off. And what you can do to help your produce last longer in the refrigerator is number one, I don't like to wash it until I'm ready to use it. Although with greens, you can wash them off, spin them in a salad spinner, lay them out like on a paper towel or a dishcloth to dry, and then wrap them in between paper towels, put them in a baggie and a Ziploc baggie and put them in your crisper and they'll last that way for about up to a week. The other thing I've done is layer it thin layers of greens in between paper towels in like a 9x13 pan. And that way I've got my salad greens all chopped up for the week and I just need to go and grab them, layer them in between paper towels to absorb the moisture because the moisture is what's gonna make them spoil a little bit quicker. So that really does help. They'll stay for up to a week, and that way, no excuses not to have your lunchtime salad or your salad with your dinner. It's already chopped, ready, prepped, and ready to roll. So hopefully that will help you. But you can also do that with like your squash and your eggplant is just wrap the whole entire vegetable in a paper towel. And that's a case where you would not want to wash it first. And it will stay in the refrigerator like that for maybe a week or two. Okay, let's see here. Question from Laura. How many watermelon can I grow together up a trellis? And growing sugar baby. Okay, it really depends on how big your garden bed is or how big your trellis is. The one that I have behind me here, this is a pretty good sized trellis. You could probably grow for sugar babies, I'd say maybe 3 to 4 fruit on it. For a full-size watermelon, I might grow 1 or 2. You can plant things on trellises closer together because you're growing them up, not out, and you can kind of manage the size a little bit by trimming off some of the leaves and that type of thing. For the ladder mesh trellis, what I did, that one's a little bit shorter. The ladder mesh itself is, I believe it's 8 or 10 feet long. When you arch it over, it's going to make an arch you know, around half that height. So I planted one at either end, but I also planted some seeds. So one at either end is probably pretty good for that. And I may end up thinning out one of the seedlings that pops up as it grows. But if your plant gets too crowded, you can just thin it out, kind of trim off some of the leaves, and you should be good to go. But you know what? Just experiment with it. Try it out. It's gonna be different depending on the container size, depending on your trellis size. Try it out. See what works for you, and then make adjustments as you go. Never be afraid to experiment in the garden. Okay, we're going to move on to question number three that I have here from the YouTube videos. And this is one about raised bed soil. So lots of questions on raised beds, on raised bed soil. This is one from Tommy Daly. So Tommy, if you're here, here you're going to get your question answered. Okay, Tommy says, I planted my gardens 3 to 4 weeks ago. My tomatoes, cucumbers have hardly grown 2 inches. It's been very unseasonably cool and overcast, but I also noticed that my soil looks very sandy. Would it still benefit to add healthy soil on top and water it in? I can't till it too much with seedlings in the ground, and I'd hate to lose my entire season because of the condition of my soil. Okay, you definitely can still add in amendments to your soil, even if you've already planted your garden beds and didn't top off your soil or didn't amend it first. And you don't need to till your soil in. What you'd want to do is just add some of your amendments on top, like your compost. It's actually called top dressing. So you add your compost, your organic granular fertilizer, and then just kind of go through and kind of mix it into the soil with your hands around your plants. And you definitely do need to feed your plants if you want them to grow. So especially if you're planting in a raised bed that you used last year or containers that you used last year, your plants from last year really took a lot out of the soil. So you want to go in and amend that, and definitely need to keep your plants on a regular fertilizing schedule. And part of the reason why it may not have grown, I know a couple of my garden beds are kind of stalling out because I planted them really early and the weather just got kind of weird. It's not so much that I planted them any earlier than normal, but the weather this year has just been wonky all over the place. So typically I get the warm weather veggies planted out the first day of spring, and then it warms up. But this year we had nights into the 40s after that. So a lot of times when you get those veggies out there, you've got the cold nights that come in, they might get a little bit stunted, they might just kind of stall out, and then as the weather warms up, you're going to see them really take off. And if you're here in Southern California, one thing that's very, very typical this time of the year is what we call the May gray. When we get into June, we call it the June gloom. It's basically a marine layer that just kind of hangs around till 10 or 11 o'clock, sometimes noon every day. So we're not near getting all the hours of sunlight that you would normally get, you know, in the summertime. So you may be getting 3 to 4 hours of sunlight less a day. So be patient, hang in there. Definitely do top dress your plants with the compost, worm castings, and some organic granular fertilizer, and then water in really well with a water soluble fertilizer. And you should see them take off very, very soon. Now, I've got my whole fertilizing schedule that I recommend in my book on raised bed gardening. So if you're someone who likes it all written down for you, this is going to be a really good schedule for you to follow during the summer months. Your plants do need fertilizing regularly if you want them to really take off and produce. So don't forget to do that. And you can grab a copy of my raised bed gardening book. It's got all the info in here for you over at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. When you grab it on my website, I give you a nice personalized and signed copy, a personalized note inside, and you get a signed copy. So head over there and grab it, and you should be good to go with fertilizing your raised beds. Okay, let's check here in the chat and see what other questions are going by here and see what's going on. Patty says, what granular fertilizer do you suggest? There are so many good brands out there. I really don't recommend any particular brand. I would just try and find a good organic one when you go to your garden center. And I've used lots of different kinds. They work really well. A couple of products that I do really love that I use all the time, like the Vermastera worm castings, is a great soil amendment. It's not a granular soil amendment, but it is a time-released soil amendment that I add kind of my trifecta. The compost, the worm castings, and an organic granular fertilizer work really well together to kind of slowly release nutrients throughout the growing season. And then you also do want to combine it with the water solubles. One of my go-tos is the fish fertilizer, as well as the Vermicera Vitality. So definitely use those in combination throughout the growing season to really jumpstart your garden. Jerry, would you mind moving the umbrella a little bit more over me? Thank you. Okay, so back to the chat here. Let's see what other questions you have. And scroll back through here. Monica, how to help sugar baby watermelon leaves? They are curling inwards. Okay, that could be something called leaf curl, which I know happens a lot with tomatoes. And when it happens with tomatoes, you want to make sure that you have a really regular watering schedule. It can happen in times of hot weather. Thank you. Or when the temperature changes real suddenly. So I would definitely recommend keeping your watering schedule, regular. Drip irrigation really does help with that. And then a lot of times the leaf curl really doesn't impact the fruit itself. Just making a few adjustments here. The fruit itself or the health of the plant. And a lot of times it will correct itself once the temperature kind of evens out and once your watering schedule evens out. So keep an eye on it, make those adjustments, and hopefully that will really help with your sugar babies. Okay, let me scroll back through here. And here we go. Angela says, some cucumber plants in the raised bed have yellowing leaves. Others look fine. They are next to each other. Your thoughts? Usually, a lot of times when there's yellowing leaves, it could be a couple of different things. It could be a lack of nitrogen. It could be too much water. It could be some type of disease. So what I like to do is usually just kind of keep those yellowing leaves trimmed off if you can, and kind of evaluate how you've been taking care of your plants. If you think any of those particular factors might be the issue, you want to correct that and then wait a couple of weeks and then see how things go, if things improve. You do want to be careful though, not to just automatically dump fertilizer or spray your plants with water just because, you know, something might be going wrong. I think that's all of our immediate response is to either fertilize it again or water it again. So just kind of evaluate what's going on. Did I just fertilize last week? Then you're probably not going to want to fertilize again. Am I watering too much? Then you want to back off on the watering and see if the problem corrects itself. Are there spots on the leaves? Is it some type of disease? Then you want to number one, trim off the diseased leaves, but then try and figure out what type of disease might be affecting your plants and then treat it accordingly. There is a really good resource for pests and disease over on bonai.com. It's called the Pest and Disease Problem Solver. So it's fantastic. I've been using it a lot. It has pictures of all types of garden pests if you need some help identifying what is attacking your plants, but it also has pictures of diseases if you're trying to figure out what diseases your plants are being affected with. And then the cool thing is it suggests products or ways that you could help fight that. So super good resource. Highly recommend that you bookmark that and go over and check it out if you're having those types of issues on any of your plants. Okay, let's see here. I'll scroll back through the chat here and see what's going on. Jackie is growing Crimson Sweet watermelon. That's going to be a delicious variety, Jackie. Those big, huge watermelon are just the showstoppers in the garden and always really, really fun to grow. Okay, let's see here. Bruce says, follow up to the yellow leaves on the cucumber question. What if only the edges are yellow? Other cukes in the same grow bag do not have yellow leaves. I would just kind of hang in there, Bruce. It's really hard to say exactly what that problem might be, but if only the edges are yellow, just kind of hang in there. Sometimes it happens again with temperature changes, maybe when you're transplanting. If the problem is starting to progress, I would definitely pull that leaf off so it doesn't spread to other plants in the same container. Okay, so hopefully that helps you there. Cucumbers are such a fun vegetable to grow. And I don't know about you guys, but I have really been hankering for the taste of homegrown tomatoes and fresh cucumbers. Don't have any ready to harvest yet, but hopefully we'll have it in the garden very soon. So I'm sure you're hankering for it just like I am. Okay, the next question here is on composting. And composting is a great way to get free garden fertilizer and save a ton of money on your in your garden. And the question is from Days in My Life. How is the composting going? Will there be worms in the compost? Because I'm also trying in my backyard. Okay, composting is growing great. Go back and watch our series on that. We did a couple of videos on composting in the smaller size compost sack. It's a 50 gallon as opposed to the original 100 gallon. It's a whole lot easier to collect materials for the smaller size, and it fits really nicely on a patio. We have our mini compost sack up on our deck right next to my little pizza garden. It's breaking down. I just checked it before the live stream, and we've been turning it maybe once a week or so. The more you turn it, the quicker it's going to break down, and it's just about ready. So very excited about that. As far as worms go, if you're hot composting, you probably won't have worms in it right away until it breaks down, and then the worms manage to find their way into the Smart Pots containers because they're aerated. They have teeny tiny little holes, and often there's worm eggs in the soil, or if you're adding worm castings to your compost, which you can definitely do that because it has little tiny worm eggs in the compost. So oftentimes the worms will find their way in, and especially into the finished compost. But when you're using leaves in your compost, the worms absolutely love the leaves and will definitely find their way in and also into your garden beds. You can certainly add worms if you want to. Don't have to, but it's always a good sign to find them. And the leaves bring them in like crazy. So if you haven't started composting, highly recommend it. The mini smart post compost sack is a great way to go. And you can grab those over at smartpots.com and use the code CALLIEKIM. You get a 10% discount. I wanted to show you some of the finished compost and give you a little bit more information about how I compost. I've got a couple different piles. The one that's in process, like the little mini raised bed, compost sack. And then I have a finished bin that I keep up on the side of my house where I dump all my finished compost that I can use on the garden. When it's finished, it looks like this, smells nice and earthy. And sometimes you still see little pieces of eggshells, maybe avocado pits or something like that, the things that take a little bit longer to break down. But this is finished and ready to use on the garden. And what you can do is just sprinkle some around the base of your plants, kind of rub it in and then water it in. And this is good to do maybe once a month or so to your garden beds. Or if you have a container, maybe that just isn't doing so well, add some compost to it and then water it in. And you'll be amazed at how it helps your soil be nice and healthy and really helps your plants take off. So I've got my finished pile. I've got my pile in process, or my compost sack in process, where I'm not adding any new material to it. I'm just allowing it to break down. And once that's all broken down, I'll put that into my finished pile. Then I've got a pile that I am, or a compost sack that I'm adding things to, such as your, you know, things that come out of your garden, maybe spent flowers when you're pruning things. Throw that in there. If you've got your kitchen scraps, you can throw those in there as well. And when I'm ready to build a whole new little mini compost sack, I'll go ahead and fill it all the way to the top. That particular pile, and then I'll let that one break down, and then I'll just kind of cycle through my compost like that. I have a finished pile in process, and then a pile that I'm actually adding scraps to. So that way you have three different piles that you're kind of rotating through, and you have a good supply of compost always in process. So hopefully that will help you get some more compost in your garden. But again, don't need a big space. Just need a little side yard area or a little spot on your patio. The cool thing about the compost sack is you can put a cover on it. So it keeps the critters out and it keeps the heat in. So it really is a very effective way to compost. So let me see what other questions we have in the chat here. Anything about composting? Would love to answer some questions about that as well. Oh, so here is Days in My Life here, who asked one of the questions. I made compost in my kids' old pack and play. That's a great idea. When I was in another state, and now when I visited it, it was fully done but could not use it. Now I'm making it in grow bags. So yeah, great way to do it. And even if you don't have room for a compost sack, you can make it in a small little 5 gallon smart pots like this. And I've got a video on how to make it in a small space. The key is really getting your materials in smaller pieces when you're making your pile here for a quicker breakdown. So the smaller you can get the pieces, the quicker they're going to break down. In the video I made on composting in the 5 gallon, I actually put the scraps in a blender to just puree them, and they really break down quickly that way. Okay, what other questions do you have? Pop it here in the chat, and we'll go through and answer as many as we can here in the live stream. Okay, for a 5 gallon grow bag, how many bags do you need? It depends on how much compost you want to make or how much you want to grow. So you can do as many or as little as you want. It's totally up to you. And you can grab those 5 gallon blacks over at CallieKimGardenAndHome.com. Embroidered with Callie Kim and Smart Pots together, you really can't go wrong with that. Hindi360, hi Kim, do you vermicompost? You know what, Hindi360, I actually used to a while back, but what I found is I was putting so much time into it and not really getting enough that I needed for the garden space that I have. So I don't do it anymore, but it's definitely a great way to go if that's something you're interested in. And it's really a fun process. Those worms really do eat those food scraps quickly. Then you have your own worm casting. So that's fun as well. Okay, let's see here. How did your grape trellis go? I just saw a brief video on it. This is from Region 7. And the grapes, right now the trellis is really taken off with the grape trellis or the grapevine. The grapevine usually grows really well. We have trouble getting grapes from it though. The grapes will form and come on. And a lot of times the birds or the squirrels or the rats will get them. So we haven't gotten a huge harvest of grapes from those yet. But it grows beautiful, it looks really pretty, and maybe one of these years we're gonna get some grapes. But a lot of times I'm so busy in other areas of the garden, I don't get to putting the bird netting over it in time, and then the critters get the grapes. But we've trimmed it back, and it's taking off and growing really well so far this year. Okay, Patricia, great idea. I have an old dog run and I'm planning on making a compost bin out of it. So yeah, just get creative, get resourceful. Look around your garden and around your house or your garage, see what materials you have available to you, and then see what you can make out of what you already have. So it's a really great way to just be very cost effective in the garden. Okay, this is a question from Jerry Webb. Can I compost with kitchen scraps and cardboard alone? I don't have much grass and no leaves to add. Okay, Jerry, you definitely can. You do want to find a cardboard would be a brown material. You want to have a good mix of browns and greens. So check over on our compost video, and you know I mentioned things that are browns versus greens. And as long as you have about a 3-to-1 ratio of browns and greens, things will break down. And you know, you don't have to have exactly that exact ratio, but as long as you generally have a ratio of browns and greens, things will break down and make compost really, really nicely for you. And there's lots of videos on our compost playlist to help you figure out what the browns and greens are. Okay, let's see. Charmac, did you make those wooden tomato cages behind you? No, I didn't make those. I've had those for several years. I got them from a local garden center right near us, but they really are nice. They give the garden a really nice organic look, and I like the different heights of them. If you live anywhere in the San Fernando Valley in Southern California, you can stop in at Topanga Nursery, and they had those there. At least they had them last year. I haven't checked this year, but they're a super fun trellis to grow on. And by the way, you guys, get one of your last looks here at the nasturtiums. They are fading quickly in the heat. It's probably the last week for them. It's always kind of bittersweet to pull them out because they're so pretty, trailing over the different levels of the garden here. But on the other hand, I'm usually kind of ready for them to come out when they do, because they do take up a lot of space. They start to look a little bedraggled. And so I've been pulling them out little by little to make room for the warmer the vegetables. So I don't know if you have nasturtiums in your garden or if you ever feel a little bit bittersweet about pulling out something that's kind of at the end of its life, but that's how I'm feeling this week about the nasturtium. So get your last look. We're also going to be doing a garden tour this week, so make sure you stay tuned for that. And pulling out the nasturtiums probably after that garden tour. So it'll be kind of sad, but kind of good too to replace it with some brand new plants. Okay, yeah, Tina, it really depends on the weather. Tina says, meanwhile, my nasturtiums are just coming up. So if you live in a season or a climate where you're just getting into your spring cool weather season, still under 75 degrees, some people like in the Pacific Northwest or in the northern areas like in Canada, you might be able to grow nasturtiums all summer because it might rarely get above 70. But here in California, they're actually lasting about a month longer than they normally do because of the cooler spring that we've had. But here it is, almost June 1st. They're just now coming out, and they may kind of pop back up throughout the summertime. A lot of times in partial shaded areas where you're in a hot climate, they will still grow in the summer. You may not get as many blooms, but you may have some occasional ones popping up in shaded areas. Okay, Ramona, toilet paper rolls break down a bit quicker. That's a great thing to add to your compost as well because they're nice and thin. You can easily cut them up into smaller sizes to help them break down in the compost. Gardener Tom, thank you so much for all your wonderful comments. Anything you can compost will break down faster if they are crushed. Absolutely. So a quick path to fast compost is to really cut into small pieces anything that you put in there. If you're using leaves, what you could do to break them down smaller is throw them in a trash can and with safety glasses, put a weed whacker in there and whack them up smaller, or you can lay them out on your lawn and mow them over with your lawnmower. And you're going to be amazed at how much quicker they break down once things are broken down, once things are cut into small pieces. Okay, so let's scroll through the chat here and see what's going on here in the chat. As far as questions go, Deb Smith, thank you very much. I love your garden tours. I'm working on geraniums in zone 6A. So that's going to be fun. It's always fun to see what people grow in different zones, depending on the temperatures. And, you know, it's really fun to hear that in the chat. That's one great thing about the chat is people are here from all over the world, from Europe, from Africa. We have people here from all over the US and Canada. So it's really fun to get suggestions and ideas and just hear how people grow in different zones. And when you start your vegetables, when you're getting your harvest, that type of thing. So it's a really fun way to grow it. Okay, scroll through here. Big shade cloth definitely always helps. Ramona, I'm glad you like the garden tours. That's a lot of fun. We have made some changes in the garden this year. So if you missed last month's garden tour, you definitely don't want to miss this one. We'll be showing some of the changes that we made as well as some things we've been planting and just different projects that we've been working on. And that should probably be out probably later in the week here. Lori, yeah, I hear you, Lori. Eating avocado toast and dreaming of my first tomatoes. You and me both. I've got my pizza garden planted in the 100-gallon smart pots right up by our pizza oven. And I've been checking it every day. The flowers are starting to come on the tomatoes and the peppers. And we're so excited about having some friends over when I have the tomatoes and peppers and just wandering around the garden and picking what people want to put on their garden fresh pizza. So let me know here in the chat what you're excited about picking, what you're excited about making. We're just getting started with the gardening season and it's going to be a good one this year. I guarantee it. And we're going to be doing this together. We've got lots of fun content to come here throughout the summer months. Okay, nasturtiums are already fading in, I hear you, Patricia, in Arizona, already fading, and Armenian cucumbers will be going in their place. So it's always good to have something else going to replace whatever you're pulling out. So if you can, be thinking ahead about 30 days to about 6 weeks ahead of time. Be thinking about what you want to be planting in about 4 to 6 weeks. So if you're pulling out your nasturtiums, hopefully you have something else started from seed indoors, ready to put in its place. So for me, I'll be pulling those out and planting warm weather flowers, which are zinnias and dahlias are going in hopefully this week. I've got some perfusion zinnias, which are the smaller dwarf zinnias that I love to put along the edges of the garden beds. They kind of spill over. They're about a 1 to 2 foot tall plant and look really, really pretty. So if you haven't quite got there yet and you haven't quite thought ahead to start seeds indoors, start now. So in about 6 weeks time, you're going to be into the hot summer months. You're going to really want to have your heat tolerant greens growing. So those are things like chard, kale. Malabar spinach is a great hot weather green, New Zealand spinach. There's so many different types of kale. So definitely be thinking about starting some of those seeds indoors soon so they're ready when you're pulling out your lettuce, you have something to take its place. And you can grab the heat tolerant green seed collection. It's got 5 varieties in there for you to get rolling. So definitely try and be thinking ahead about 4 to 6 weeks. And a lot of things you can succession plant throughout the summer, like your greens, your heat tolerant greens. Cucumbers, like Patricia mentioned, are a great thing to succession plant and grow all summer long. Okay, Tina, yeah, the kale is super heat tolerant, also very cold tolerant, Tina. So it's something that you can grow in warm climates and in cool climates. Okay, the Tiny Tim tomatoes are also a good thing to succession plant because they go from seed to harvest super quickly. So Ricardo is saying my Tiny Tims are about ready to ripen. They're a determinate tomato, but they are so stinking productive. Tiny Tims often will produce for several months and they're just an absolutely delicious tomato. That's one of my very favorites to grow. I've got some going in the house right now that would be moving outside real soon. Yes.
She was wondering what these purple.
Oh. The purple flower, I meant to mention those too. Those are, let me see if I can move. Can we see them in the video there? Oh, I'm gonna scooch the camera over a little bit. Okay, so the purple flowers that Jerry's talking about are called salvia, and those are absolutely beautiful. And the cool thing about salvia is it's a huge, huge bee attractor. The plant is about, I wanna say about 2 feet tall, and it's just constantly got bees buzzing around it. So you can get some salvia planted, I highly recommend it. I have some white salvia and some purple salvia, but they really are attracted to the purple salvia a lot more than the white. Bees are very partial to the color purple. So lavender, salvia, anything purple you can get going in your garden is really gonna be a big bee attractor. So I think that's gonna wrap it up for us today. What a fun Q&A this has been. Really glad you guys joined us. Do tune in this week. We've got some fun videos planned on strawberries, the garden tour, and don't forget to grab your May Grow Your Groceries with Kelly Kim subscription box. Today and tomorrow are the last day the May one will be available, and you will not wanna miss out on that. Jerry, any other special last words for today?
No, I do think that Kim did a great job maintaining her cool here, even though we had some little issues there at the very beginning. I don't know how she does it. She stays so smooth, keeps things on track. So good job to you.
Thank you.
And thank you all for your patience, too.
Yes, thank you so much. And don't forget, we are off next week for Memorial Day. We'll be back on the live stream at noon Pacific time in 2 weeks, where we'll kick off the month of June together.
I also want to say thank you to Smart Pots for having your team here. I think that's a really cool asset that we all have access to them and can ask any of the questions about their containers or how to do things. So Smart Pots, you all rock too. So thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for joining us, and I hope you have a great 2 weeks. We'll see you soon. Jerry, you need new gloves.
Oh.
Tell them why you have one finger missing from your glove there.
That's by plan, actually, because my camera is touch sensitive on the display, and I can tell the camera where to focus by pressing the backside of the camera.
That's so right.
That's
He's
part of the plan.
He's a true camera guy. All right, guys, have a great week, and we will see you later. Oh, no worries, Charlene. Have a great week. Bye-bye.
Bye.